All right. Welcome, everyone. This is the review meetup for the Fast.ai Deep Learning for Coders 2019 edition. By review, I mean that we've already had, like, I personally had this chance to interact with this meetup while we were going through the live course. And I was more on the receiving end, and I've learned more than I was able to contribute. But right now we're sort of gearing up for the part two of the course by reviewing, or for those of us who've recently joined, we're going through it again. So you can sort of again benefit from this. The agenda for today is, we do not have any mini presentations on today's agenda. So even still, if anyone wants to present any idea, please let me know. But otherwise, I'll just be happy to go over the lessons. I actually plan to do a few demos, but I'll sort of give a walkthrough why my ideas did not work. I was planning to do a language model and a few examples similar to what have been done in the Fast.ai course, but those did not go very well. So I'll sort of share where I failed, and maybe someone else could pick up my faults in that. And about the study group, we meet every Saturday at 9 a.m. PST. And this is done, as you can see, using the Zoom chats. Also, we have a Slack channel. So if, in case you haven't joined the Slack channel and you just joined using the email URL, please make sure you join the Slack channel as well, because we're constantly sharing materials over there as well. So also, I've shared a link to the Kaggle discussion that I posted. So please make sure that you leave an upvote there, because it also makes it visible to other Kagglers who might be interested in the Fast.ai course. And I had received a bunch of questions. This is my presentation from the last meetup. And I had given a demo to Introduction to Image Augmentation. So I received a few questions about the images that I've shown. And these are based from my personal projects, I would say. And I do have the client's permission to share these. So this was and I did not use Fast.ai, but I did use image augmentation techniques in all of these. And now that Fast.ai sort of supports these, back in the day, these image augmentations were not supported by Fast.ai. So this is more of an overview of how you could, you know, use or leverage Fast.ai for these cases if you're going to be working on these right now. So this was an image from a medical pill, and the target was to be able to pick up this data for whatever needs of the client. And I had shared what worked best in these cases and what didn't. And about the serial box, so this is something called image search engine. If you've ever used an Android phone with Google Lens, so if you just pinpoint a camera to any product and you're able to find relevant links to it, this is what Google Lens does. And it's called image search engine. So basically you just click an image and you're able to find similar products on the internet. And this is where another few image augmentations came in handy. If you have any other questions, just leave them in the chat and I'll be happy to answer those. Also, I've shared the Kaggle kernel links for today's lesson. So in case you want to use those, please make sure you can access them. And in case you have any errors running them, please make sure to just tag me in the chat. My handle is @init27 and I'll be happy to help you figure the or sort the errors out. So for today's lesson, there are three notebooks that were covered in the lecture. The first one is IMDB, then it's a collaboratory filtering and tabular data. IMDB notebook was more focused on identifying if a movie review is positive or negative. And why would you want to do this is because this is one of the major, so to speak, challenges in NLP. somewhat similar to ImageNet. So classifying a text and as positive or negative is one of the leaderboards, you can say, or something where you want to achieve state-of-the-art accuracy in. And Fast.ai is the Fast.ai team has actually smashed the accuracy for this. And this notebook is sort of a walkthrough for this idea. This is based on three key concepts. First is you use a pre-trained network for this. So how this works is similar to image data. And if you follow Sylvain Gugger on Twitter, he actually shared a photo where he has asked us to spot the difference between the image data bunch and the text data bunch. So what team Fast.ai is trying to do is they're really trying to bring these two very together, that the API for doing this is pretty similar in both cases. So how we get started is we use a pre-trained model, which is trained on the Wiki Text 103, which is a huge data set of, I think, all of the Wikipedia documents. And what this is, it's called a language model. What is a language model? A language model is something that allows you to generate sentences. For example, the recent OpenAI GPT-2 model that had a lot of traction on Twitter. So you use this, then you fine tune it. For example, how you would go about in an image data set. You fine tune it to your particular data set, which in our case is IMDb. Why are we interested in IMDb data set? So this is a very interesting data set in the case that it has about 100,000 movie reviews, 50,000 of which are labeled, 50,000 of which are unlabeled. So according to NLP researchers, this is sort of a big enough data set for you to test your models around. So that's why we're interested in this data. Next, we fine-tune our pre-trained language model on the IMDb data set. We create a fine-tuned language model on the IMDb data set. And finally, we tune it to make the classification if the movie review was positive or negative. And to give you how good of a result the team was able to achieve with this is, just using the simple step, we can achieve 94.3 accuracy. And the accuracy prior to this was 94.1, which is a big difference, especially in the deep learning picture. So to give you a walkthrough of what exactly is going on in this notebook, let me just pause and check if there are any questions right now.
No, there are no questions in the chat.
All right, thank you. Any other questions that anyone wants to ask? All right, I'll continue. Please feel free to interrupt me if you want to ask anything. So one thing I want to point out is trying to make this work for sarcasm detection news headlines, and that did not go very well for a bunch of reasons that I'll just tell after this presentation. So you can just ignore this, these errors. Most of these are because of I did not make it work with this particular data set. Just to point out, you can do it using read JSON helper in pandas, and Fast.ai does support pandas out of the box, so you'll just sort of index that into the library and make it work. I'll share the link to this data set as well in case anyone else wants to give it a try. But how ideally you would go about this is you'll just use the IMDb sample data set, which is Fast.ai's own subset of IMDb, to be able to play around with it. And afterwards, after loading the data bunch, you might want to save it further just to be able to load it afterwards, because this does involve some few steps of pre-processing, which will furthermore save you some time. One thing I want to point out is I did do a Git pull today, and the load data function wasn't apparently working, and I was on the latest course repository, so I'm not sure if they have it updated yet, but load data as of today isn't working. So after you've sort of pre-processed your or just loaded your data set, what you want to do is you want to tokenize each of your symbols. So if you're trying with data frame, you need to pass these few functions. Otherwise, what tokenization does is you assign each word a certain number, and you'll sort of, because the reason for doing that is neural nets aren't good with words or strings. what neural nets are good at is predicting numbers, right? So you'll just want to predict numbers, and for that you'll have to create these into sets of numbers called tokens. After that, we numericalize this. So what we do is we create numbers respective to each word that is there in our vocab. What is the vocab? Vocab is the collection of all of the words that are there in our corpus. What is a corpus? The collection of text that we have. So once that is tokenized, you can feed it into your neural net. And after this, we just call the data block API. Again, for this, now we're going to create the language model. And for this, Jeremy has just downloaded the complete IMDb dataset. And this is pretty compute intensive. So even on my 2080 Ti, this took around 3 to 4 hours. So I'll caution you against the time that this might take. Now, what a language model is, like I said, you just want to make sure that you're able to predict the next word or just create a model of your language and generate words using this. And as we learn that this is pretty helpful in creating a text classifier. So using this as a pre-trained network is really helpful in giving an accuracy boost that you might want. Now, once we have the data language model ready, so this is from DF, and ideally you'd want this from CSV along with the paths. So these were the changes for my own experience that I was sort of just experimenting right before the meetup. What you would ideally want is you would want to filter by folder. So the IMDb dataset has these three folders created in it by default. And what random split by PCT does is, PCT stands for percentage. So you randomly split and keep 10% of the training dataset as your validation dataset. This is necessary to be able to check if you're overfitting or not to the training dataset. Now, finally, we load the labels that we've already saved. And again, this takes 5 to 10 minutes depending on what resources you're on. So you'll again want to save these to be able to load them on again later. So once you've done that, you can just check on the batches perfectly. And now the steps are pretty similar to just doing image, just creating an image learner. We'll pass on the data link, which is the data language model. And ideally you'd be passing a ResNet X equal to 3450, whatever. So here we're passing AWD LSTM. AWD LSTM is also something that has been created by the creator of IMDb dataset. And in general, this is what gives you a state of the art accuracy on this. Dropout is something that allows you to, this is the value that we said. Dropout, what that does is it randomly deletes your weights. So what we're doing is deleting 30% of the weights at random. Why would you want to do this, or why is this helpful? To avoid overfitting. And if you're going over to the extreme, for example, if you set this up to 0.7, you might underfit. In that case, you might want to bring it to a lower value. When do you know you're overfitting, your accuracy improves to an extent, and then it sort of plateaus and starts to get worse. So that's a sign of overfitting. How are you underfitting? When your validation loss is lesser than your training loss. So in that case, you're underfitting. Next steps from here are pretty standard. You do the learn.plot and you fit once, unfreeze, fit further. Momentum is discussed extensively in this lecture. So for now, just trust these defaults, okay? And something that was interesting in this lesson was that we part by part unfreeze each layer. So what Jeremy has suggested is once you unfreeze just the layer prior to the, or the penultimate layer or the layer just prior to the last layer, you sort of train on it. And then you freeze the layer just before it and further train. So that has proved to give a better accuracy. Now we have a good enough language model, and there are a few tricks to improve this further. I think these have been discussed in the forums if you want to look them up. And this is a two-step problem in the sense that you need an encoder and a decoder. So an encoder takes your input, encodes it, and trains the neural net. And at the end of the neural net, you have your decoder, which sort of gives out the language model or your predictions. So we just need the encoder for our original task. Our original task was to classify the movie reviews if they're positive or negative. Now we're going to train the classifier. And again, we have the folder split in our case. So we just pass it the validation link as the test set. And we have two classes out here, negative or positive. So once we've loaded the data and we set the batch size, this is where we'll, you know, go over the part by part unfreezing.
So there's a question in the chat. So Jayesh is asking, you said we delete weights. Isn't this drop connect? As far as I know, in dropout, we delete activations of a layer, and in drop connect, we delete weights. Is this correct or am I confused?
I'm not sure if I use the correct terminology. So I think we randomly delete activations. I think JS is right.
Okay.
So back to the discussion. Next, what's interesting is this lecture. In this lecture is for NLP, you would want to freeze 2 minus 2. So what this does is just unfreezes the last two layers. Contrary to what we do is we just unfreeze all of the layers and then for the train. And one more thing I'd like you all to pay attention to is 2.6 to the power 4. So what Jeremy has suggested is based on his intense experimentation, these are great values. So dividing your first value of the slice by this in general gives a really good result. Make sure you check this out or experiment this whenever you're trying this. And finally, we unfreeze the last three layers, train a bit more, and then unfreeze the complete model and train it for 2 epochs. So this gives us a great accuracy of 94%, which is, I think, still the current state of the art. And the reason for going with this funky sort of unfreezing is because if you did not do this, or if you just directly unfreeze, I remember from the last MOOC, we had to train for 10 to 20 epochs for the complete unfreezing. But in case if you do this partial unfreezing, in total, I think it just took 5 or 6 epochs, which is much faster and really great compared to that. So I'll just pause for a bit for any questions related to this, and then I'll move on with collaborative filtering and tabular data. Ahmed, the recordings will be uploaded to the YouTube channel of TWiML AI. Another thing that I sort of would need feedback from you all is that I was trying to make a few similar models and those did not go very well. So I was trying to make a headline sarcasm detector and it would just stop working, in the sense that once I was through this step of creating the text class data bunch, the accuracy wouldn't improve, or I'll just get weird tokens out of the model.
So for that sarcasm detector, what data set did you use, and how many labeled examples did you have?
I had 26,000 examples, and it's a data set from Kaggle. I think it was a competition earlier.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So someone has asked in the chat about the references to hyperparameter. I think what Jeremy has told us is that he used a random forest to do, and he created a random forest on top of his hyperparameters and used some interpretation techniques through which he came to this result. It has not been published, but Stephen Merity, so his usual internet name is Merity, he has published some results similar to this. You'll be able to find those if you look him up.
I'm having some difficulty with what on the image classifiers, it's quite easy to see where we're going and what are we doing. But how do we know when we see a 95%, 94% accuracy? What's that doing? What are we predicting the next word? Because of the results I'm looking at, it looks a bit like gobbledygook to me.
No, in this one, we're predicting whether the movie recommendation is positive or negative.
Oh, right.
Yeah, that's all we're doing. It's a two-class problem.
Yeah, so you first create the language model and then you create the classifier. So the 95% accuracy is for that.
And for language model, 30% is pretty good as per Jeremy.
And he's also mentioned that if you're working on something very domain specific, you might be able to get it up to 50%. And apparently 30 or 50% is really good.
That's for the language model where you're predicting the next word in it after a series of words, right?
Right.
So what are the world class results for a language model then? I mean, Jeremy said 30% is pretty good, but what's the actual best that people can get?
The absolute best currently was from OpenAI, which hasn't been released publicly. Mm-hmm. So it's called OpenAI GPT-2. I'm not sure of the accuracy values or others. So again, there are a bunch of data sets on which they've claimed their state of the art results.
Thank you.
You might want to check out Deca NLP. It's from Salesforce and it's a 10 class problem. So if you have a good enough language model, it'll do great on all those 10 tests. It's called Deca NLP. The spelling is in the chat. So moving on to collaborative filtering. This wasn't discussed in intense in the coding portion. This was covered in the Excel sheet. And since I do not have Microsoft Excel installed on this, I'll sort of just skip over that. Or I could open it up on Google Sheets, but I think Jeremy has done a better job at explaining those. I'll still be happy to go over it. So collaborative filtering is the recommendation engine that we can see sort of implemented in Netflix, maybe a very advanced version of it. So what the aim with this is, you have a new user and you have a bunch of existing users who have seen a bunch of movies, and your new user wants to watch a movie and you want to find out if they're going to like it or not. And why is this useful for you? It's a business problem in the sense that the longer your user is stuck to your platform, for example, on YouTube, there are a lot of these paid movies coming out now. So if someone is stuck to your platform, or in the sense that you're making very good recommendations, they'll be watching more content on your platform. How does that help YouTube, for example? YouTube gets to push out more advertisements to the users and they get to bring more advertising people onto their platform. So it's profitable for them in that sense. So this is where collaborative filtering comes into play in the business scenario. This in the lecture, this is a simple problem. So you have a bunch of user IDs and you have a bunch of movie IDs, and a few columns are missing in the sense that not every user has watched every movie. So for the users that have watched the movies, they would give the movie a rating from 1 to 5, based on 5 being the highest and 1 being the lowest on how much they would, how well they like the movie. And for now, we just ignore the timestamp in this particular lecture. So for this particular problem, we're creating a collab data bunch from DF. In general, if you're working on any problem in Fast.ai, just problem name under like dash problem name data bunch dot whatever helper function you're going to use is the approach for it. Image data bunch from CSV from DF, collab data bunch from CSV from DF are the general approaches. And another reason for setting wireframes from 0 to 5.5 is using sigmoid to generate the results. So sigmoid, it sort of plateaus at the maximum value. So you'll never be able to actually predict 5 in that case, which is why you'll want to set it to 5.5. And further, the steps are pretty similar. So you'll just create the collab learner. And number of factors isn't heavily discussed, but it's again a hyperparameter for assumption. And we fit it for 3 cycles, which gets us up to 0.65 training loss and 0.66 validation loss. This was done on the movie lens dataset, which is a dataset based on user IDs and movie IDs. And the first example was another subset of the data that has been created by the Fast.ai team for us to experiment with. After this, Jeremy did a bit of source code dive in. So if you want to find out the source code, ideally, you will go to the docs.fast.ai and we'll navigate to collab. So someone has asked any references where wiki pretend model is used in a specific domain. The only reference that I know of is in Fast.ai where we use it to predict the IMDb movie reviews. Otherwise, there's also a model zoo in Fast.ai where everyone has created language models. It sits there in the forums. I'll share the link after the meetup.
Yeah, it was for ULM fit for English, probably.
I think they've created for many languages now.
Yeah, in the zoo, it's there. Other languages. This wiki one is for English, right?
I think yes. So what I'm looking for is embedding.bias class, which was in collab learner, if I remember correctly. Yeah. So if you navigate to the docs, you'll be able to find the embedding.bias details. And if you click on the source code, this will take you to the GitHub repo where the source code is available. And what Jeremy has highlighted here is it's a pretty naive model in the sense to a simple linear layers finally stacked with the sigmoid layer. And another thing that he's pointed out is there are 2 sets of weights and biases. So user weight and ID weight and user bias and ID bias respectively. And just these few simple things were able to allow us to get a great result even on this problem. And prior to this, from what I know is this was sort of an advanced problem, and just using these simple 2-3 layered neural network has allowed us to get accuracy of pretty good extent. So in case you want to do a deep dive into the source code, you can do that using the Fast.ai docs. Any questions related to collaborative filtering? Also, if anyone is aware of any data sets similar to this, I'll be happy to run experiments this week and share those in the next meetup.
There's a Amazon data set around collaborative filtering. There's a book review data set, as well as a joke review data set as well.
Okay, if you could please share the link to those.
Yeah, let me just fetch that.
I haven't gone through the complete notebook, but just based on these 3 steps, I think maybe if it's a Kaggle competition, I'll be curious to find out how good with just these 3 steps, how far would these get me?
I just wanted to know where we have specified the validation set for this.
I'm not sure if we have specified for this.
We are getting a validation loss. So there must
I think it's set by default in collab learner.
Okay.
I do not have Fast.ai installed on this, so I cannot shift tab and check out, but.
Yep, that's okay.
I'll check on the docs if anything comes up. So we're looking at collab learner. So validation data set. We calling collab data bunch from here. Okay, so it's 20% by default of the training data set. Andy has asked a question in the chat. I've seen that in next word key recommendation keeps improving based on previous choices. I did not quite understand this question. Are you talking about the text predictor on your mobile phone? Okay, so I think those keep improving furthermore. Like, for example, I type a lot of Hindi in English, and initially the predictor wouldn't, it'll sort of autocorrect me to English words relevant to whatever I'm typing, but eventually it'll pick up whatever I want to type. So based on that, I'm assuming that they do improve with time. I think SwiftKey has a detailed blog on this if you might want to check that out. All right, moving on to tabular models. This is one of, again, the interesting areas, so to speak, because tabular data is what most of the businesses would be looking at. And again, as shown by Jeremy, that he's sort of, and also he made a comment that 90% of the time he would trust deep learning to do pretty well on tabular data. And I'm not sure if you follow the Santander competition recently. So I think many people are also using deep learning in that competition. So again, another great thing that we can sort of leverage using the Fast.ai library. Now, this is using an adult's data set. I was not able to find the reference to this in the Fast.ai data set repository. But it's, again, it's a subset of adult's data set as well. So predict in this is the salary, if it'll be more than 50,000 or less than 50,000 based on these few columns, which are working class, education, marital status, occupation, relationship, race, education, and age. This is a normalized age. So once you normalize whatever your data is, you'll have values between minus X to plus X range, depending on how you normalize it. I'm not sure what this column refers to and what education number refers to. So the few things or the only things that we need to sort of set in this problem is the categorical names of the columns. These are the columns that you will expect to be categories. For example, work class, education, marital status, occupation, so on and so forth. Continuous names are the names of the columns inside of your data frame that you expect to be continuous variables. Age, for example, would be one, and I'm not sure what this refers to. Education number is, I suppose, the number of degrees. So again, this might be a number. In some cases, for example, if ages are just a few fixed numbers, you might want to set it to categories. This is based on my personal experience. And in those cases, you might see a better performing model. Procs is something similar to pre-processing that happens in image data. Similar, but not quite in the sense that this happens prior to the data being loaded. In images, it happens on the fly. So when you're doing image augmentation, it happens in real time. And every few samples of your particular batch would be augmented. But in this case, it just does this prior to loading your data. Why would you want that to happen instead of on the move or on the fly, which would be in theory better by saving some processing time? Because you cannot calculate on missing values or you cannot calculate on unnormalized values. So you'll just be wasting time. So you would want to apply these ahead of time, and you'll want to fill in the missing values or categorify whatever columns that you have, or they, if they haven't been categorized already, and you'll want to ensure that these have been normalized. So as you can expect, we'll again call a from df, and we set the paths, the categorical names, we pass on the continuous variable names. Finally, we pass on the progs. I think a few more are supported in Fast.ai library. If you check out the docs, you pass on the labels from df. So this is the d where, and this is the salary, what we're trying to predict. You add the test data set, and finally you add on your data bunch. And just doing these few steps and calling your tabular learner, again, layers is another hyperparameter that we'll dig deeper into during the course. So just doing these few things, we're able to get 2%, which like compared to boosted trees or GBMs is pretty better, in the sense that those would take, in theory at least, or based on my experience, they would definitely take longer than this to get to such a high accuracy, definitely longer than 3 seconds. So you'd want to try these out on any Kaggle competition maybe that you're taking part in. And in the end, you just call prediction on whatever row you want. And what we want to predict here is if the particular person will have a salary of more than or less than 50,000. This is a problem that we're trying to solve. Any questions related to this notebook? Nalini has asked if I could talk about the, how the training differs between categories. So she's mentioned that embedding vectors get created, and this was discussed in the machine learning course, if I remember correctly. But from what I know, for categorical variables, you'll want to create these embedding matrices. I'll just do a quick check in the docs as well, if we can find that out. Be using tabular list from DF. Meanwhile, please feel free to unmute yourself and ask any questions that you might have. We're checking here how categorical and continuous variables are treated different inside of Fast.ai. That's what I'm trying to look into the source code for, or just the docs if I'm able to find that.
So I've pinged the paper where this comes from on this concept of
embeddings.
And yeah, so you can go through that.
Embedding is useful from what I know is because you have just one variable and you're porting it into a bigger dimensional matrix. So you give your neural net more, I think the right term here would be parameters to learn. That's why it's sort of helpful that one day of the week can be represented in a higher dimension problem, and your neural net learns how to represent a Sunday as a 5-dimension thing maybe.
Yeah. So basically, neural nets work with continuous data. Images and audio are by default continuous signals. But language models like text and tabular data, they have categorical data as well. Language, each token is itself a category. In collab filtering also, what we call latent factors are kind of embedding matrices. So whenever we encounter categorical data, we create these embedding matrices, which is a form of a vector, which the neural network learns during training, and it becomes a continuous thing, a lookup vector mapped to the specific category.
So we create that non-numerical thing into representation that is a higher dimensional numerical representation.
Yeah, basically floating point numerical. It can be numerical, but mm-hmm. floating point value, continuous numerical.
So someone asked if is it because of embedding that there's not much of token pre-processing. I'm not sure what stemming or lemmatization is and how they might be helpful.
So stemming is like learning. The stem is learned on that kind of a thing.
Could you elaborate what is stem in this
like case? In which case is it due to embedding? There is not much of token preprocessing.
Token, so I'm assuming related to NLP.
No, the token preprocessing, there is lemmatization and stemming that happens. I think Fast.ai is using spacey tokenization. So there's an inbuilt tokenizer that they're using, which does that and this stemming and lemmatization.
Let's do a source code dive for that as well after this.
Yep.
So to answer Nalini's question, I think this is what happens when you pass categorical and continuous names. I'm not sure if these are further more functions been called, but okay, so these are separated from the deep variable. And another list is created. I assume this would be passed on for the most of that in the pool. Just from my first looks, I'm not able to give a sure shot pointer that this is how these are handled. So in case anyone else knows what's going on when you're passing on the continuous and categorical variables, please feel free to jump in. This line is...
Yeah, I think it would be helpful to go through that ML lecture. Jeremy explains it pretty well in that ML lecture.
But the question asked was, how is this handled inside of the library? So that's what I'm trying to dig out.
Yes, okay.
These are all of the points that I wanted to cover for today's meetup. And I am not sure if we have any presentations lined up for today. So I'll sort of leave this open for any discussions that others might have.
Just with reference to what the material you just covered, there's a point somebody asked what stemming and lemmatization is. I'm not sure what stemming is, but lemmatization is when you... when you trace back the root word of, so you get a word and you trace back the root of it. So, no examples come to mind, but every word has a root word, and lemmatization is identifying. There's in the language model they identify that. In Spacey's language model, they're able to provide that extra information.
Right. From what I can see from this core answer, I'll just read that out. Stemming is the process of converting words of a sentence into non-changing portions. Okay, so based on this example, amusing, amusement, and amused, amuse is the stem. I think the root word form, like Joseph pointed out.
Well, stemming is different. I mean, you can see from that definition, it's the you have a group of words and there's one piece of text that doesn't change, which is A-N-U-S. But the lemmatization would say, if you look at amusement, it would trace that back to amuse. You know, the word amuse is the root of amusement. So amusing, you know, if you ask for a connection with amusing, then they would trace you back to the word amuse. That's lemmatization.
Gotcha. So root word is from which it is read, and stem is from, like, you just add branches on top of stem. So the stem stays the same, and from the root word, you sort of derive new classes, I suppose.
Well, no, you trace back to, so you have a group of words, amusing, amusement, amuse, right. amused, and that group of words is all linked to the word amuse, because that's the root word.
Right.
That's lemmatization.
Gotcha. Any other discussions or any other Kaggle competitions that anyone might have been working on recently?
I started working on the earthquake competition, but then I lost. I just couldn't keep up with it because I had other things to do. I don't know if anyone else has been keeping up with that one.
I think it's a Tableau database-based competition, right?
It's time series.
Okay.
So you get a time series of somehow a displacement measurement. So they've got this laboratory experiment with plates, and the plates are being displaced in some way. So you get the data is the displacement, and then the other thing that goes with it is the time to failure. So okay. So they're doing these laboratory experiments where they put stress on something that imitates the tectonic plates, and then when there's a catastrophic event, when the plate slips, that's the catastrophic event that they're talking about. So you're trying to predict from the time series data when the next slip is going to happen, and so it's a really interesting thing. And you have all this data from the laboratory. The problem with real earthquakes is you don't have a lot of data. There aren't a lot of earthquakes, but in the laboratory, you can create these events at will. And so you get huge, you can get a large database. And so it's really interesting, the competition, but I haven't kept up with it for a while.
But Joseph, doesn't that take a lot of domain expertise, the earthquake prediction thing?
It takes some, but... yeah, in fact, they even have links to some papers you can read. And it seems like it wouldn't be too hard. You have to have time, though, to read a couple of those papers and get up to speed on, you don't have to be a seismologist, to do it.
Okay.
I think a few discussions are already there around it. Just scrolling through casually, I can see a few discussions around it.
Yeah, the problem is if you don't get in at the beginning and start keeping up with the discussions, then you just rapidly get behind.
that is true with any Kaggle competition in general.
Yes. I started near the beginning, and I was actually able to keep up for a little while, but then I stopped having time for it. And then when I came back, it was just overwhelming. So much progress had been made.
So Nalini has mentioned in the chat that just using Fast.ai out of the box, she was able to get 77% with Titanic playground competition.
Huh.
I've been trying the Microsoft challenge, which is to predict if there will be malware in a machine or not. So that's another interesting competition. It's closer to the end. It ends on the 24th of March. Another few things that I'm particularly interested in. Go ahead.
Oh, sorry, Sonia. I was going to ask, because I'm interested in that sarcasm competition. So what's the best people have been able to do on?
I'm not sure if it was a data set or a competition. I'll just...
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry, it's a data set. It's not a competition.
Mm-hmm. But do you know what would be an example of a good score for that?
I'll just look at the kernels and see if there are any existing values. So the problem with data set is you do not have a leaderboard, or the kernels do not show a value directly.
I see. Will you leave the link to the data set on the chat?
I've shared it in the chat.
Okay, great. Excellent.
So I'm sort of also looking for suggestions that I'm interested in creating exactly similar replications of these three notebooks. So anything that come to your mind, I think someone has already pointed out to Amazon dataset and the book review dataset.
Yeah.
any ideas for language modeling? I was considering just a meme bot, maybe. Any data sets that you might know around those, or any data sets that you might be curious on?
I am interested in putting this collaborative filtering thing in production, how to build a predictor around it. So if someone has some experience or code around it, that would be really helpful for me.
I think the challenge with that would be, you know, to deal with the live data, right? It continuously, like you continuously get new users or whatever you're trying to filter on, you get new values.
Right. So most predict, so image prediction is available like in the documentation, but not a lot of examples around collaborative filtering.
Right. I'll try and see if there are any Kaggle competitions that I could look into, but I'm not sure about the production aspect of it. I'm not sure if Netflix still has those open blog posts. I think they had it earlier around their technology. So those might be worth looking into.
They combine content based and this collaborative filtering. It's a lot of complicated stuff.
Do they cover the production aspect in it?
Yeah, but like it's too complex for me to understand at a beginner level, because they have a lot of notebooks ecosystem there. So they use technologies like Kubernetes and all that. I just know the name of those things. I don't understand them.
You could maybe share those links and we could look into that this way.
Sure.
Another thing that I think I'm going to try is lyric modeling. So this is something that I'd done earlier as well, and particularly fine-tuning in that. So what I'll do is I'll use the Wiki 103 pre-trained network. I'll fine-tune it on all of the lyric corpus that is there. This is a data set on Kaggle. So we have lyrics from the past 100 songs, UK top 100 songs from the past 80 years. So I'll take the 103 model, fine-tune it on all of the data set, and then maybe just create a rap bot using it to create rap battle lyrics, or maybe just a country bot to create country lyrics around it. And that's something I'll think I'll present next week.
That's a really cool idea.
It's a good idea.
Yeah, there's also something like on Andrew Ng's class, in the classes he did on deep learning, one of the things we did was he had a database of jazz music, notes in MIDI, and he converted it to MIDI format. So then you can take that and create a language model for music, and then you can generate random music. You give it the first measure or the first few bars, and then it generates from there on. It generates music, and surprising, and it's the one we did on this course was extremely simple. And yet, the music that it generated was not terrible, you know. So okay. I think people can do a much better job with that. But the whole idea of language modeling is you're given a sequence, and then you predict what happens next, and you know the next what happens following that sequence, and that's equally applicable to words or musical notes. So that's kind of interesting. Another thing we did was we did a Shakespeare model where we took the Shakespeare corpus and created a language model from that, and then you could give the line, you know, you give a line, a phrase or something, and then from there it would generate a Shakespearean kind of dialogue from that. Mm-hmm. Pretty interesting.
I think that's one of the standard data sets for language modeling as well, the Shakespeare corpus.
Yeah, and you could also, I think the Gutenberg, the Project Gutenberg corpus might be available too, all the books that they have digitized.
People have created Eminem lyrics and Obama speeches in the past.
Yeah.
So that'll be again something that I'm interested in, just trying for fun's sake.
Yeah.
Is Twitter, are the Twitter databases public? Can you actually get a list of tweets from?
I think it's possible to scrape them.
Yes, there's a TWiP API. You can pass the keywords and it will get the tweets for you.
Also, the music aspect that you mentioned is my undergrad thesis. So in India, you have to create this finally a project. And I chose to keep it research oriented. So I'm trying to generate music using deep learning is the 50-foot view of it. I'll maybe be able to present it by next month when I have the final presentation that we have to do for our thesis.
So you're completing your undergrad thesis now?
Yeah.
Oh, that's excellent. I really like to see that.
Hopefully I'll be able to present something nice by next month. I've shared the peer link that was mentioned. Again, I'm not sure if they would allow you access to complete tweets or there might be bounds on it. Because I know for sure that people pay to get access to complete tweets. So I think you get limited access to just a certain percentage or fixed number of tweets per hour or per day. I'm not sure how it works.
I see. Another language model related idea that might be interesting, I'm sure people have tried this because of the financial aspect. I mean, you could look at a time series of stock prices, and then you could try to predict the next price, the next couple of days prices, and then you can see whether you want to buy that stock or sell it, something like that. I bet people have done that. But it's the same idea, the language modeling, you're modeling a time series of things. The things in language models are words. The things in music models are musical notes. The things in this would be stock prices. You want to predict what happens next.
Yeah, you can get the data from Quandl. So you can buy that data and there's some limited data freely
it's pretty expensive, available.
Oh, you have to pay for it?
Some of the, like the calls are limited. The API calls are limited per day.
Mm-hmm. I shared the link to Quandl as well in case anyone is interested.
Yeah, I've shared it.
Okay. I'm not very optimistic about this because even I'm not able to replicate Jeremy's accuracies on most of the things that he sort of does. And this is again, a complete another level to just use Twitter to predict stock prices. I'm not very happy.
So there's this guy called Harrison Kingsley. He teaches Python on YouTube by the name of Sendex.
Yeah.
So this guy does a lot of this financial algorithmic trading in Bitcoin as well as in stock using Bitcoin algorithms. And he allegedly makes a lot of money out of it and teaches for free.
I'm not sure if I'll be of that great level, so I haven't ventured into this space yet.
Well, you might ask yourself, if he's making so much money, how come he's trying to make money on YouTube? I mean, if he's making so much money from stocks, how come he has to make money? How come he has to teach on YouTube to make money? You would think that he's making a lot more money on stocks if he's successful.
Something that I was really interested in, so we had this data set, Cityscapes data. I'm not sure if it was Cityscapes data set, which is very similar to Lesson 3. So I want to try out the Lesson 3 machinery on that data set. And also, this guy, Sendex, that's his YouTube channel. So he does this self-driving car in GTA 5, which is a game if you're not aware of it. And I want to do image segmentation in that because that is like just a game scenario in general, based on my experience, would be similar to what is taught in Lesson 3 and see how well can it segment the GTA 5 imagery.
What's the GTA image?
GTA 5 is just a third-person game. So you're just a character inside of a real world.
Oh, okay.
Grand Theft Auto.
Oh, Grand Theft Auto.
I think we've completed our time for the meetup, and since we do not have any presentations, we can conclude the meetup if there are not any pending questions.
Sure. What will we? So next week we'll do lesson 5. And are there any other presentations that people want to make?
I'll confirm by midweek of my sort of fun experiments if those show any promise.
Sure, and then. Anybody that has any other ideas can post on the meeting channel and ask for a you know, ask for space on the agenda.
I can do a paper presentation. There was this paper called EDA, Easy Data Augmentation. And that's on text augmentation. So these guys, they just do synonym replacement or random deletion. And in their paper, they mentioned that this shows pretty promising results. So I'll do a presentation on that for sure.
That sounds good.
All right. Thanks, everyone, for joining. And we'll see you next week.